Hi there, Shedsters. Welcome to the tiniest parish in the world, but still easily big enough to fit all of you in. Which reminds me, this week, someone made a comment on the last week's Holy Shed YouTube post, which I'm afraid quickly disappeared, which saddened me because I really wanted to reply to it. I don't know the name of the person, and I won't here mention whereabouts in the world they lived, but you know who you are, and if you're watching this, please be in touch with me. I'll give you my email address in a moment. But before the comment was taken down, I did manage to copy what was written there, and it said something like this, if I just bring it up on my screen. It said, "Hello, Dave. I am a transgender man living in..." It's somewhere far, far away from here, I can tell you. "Where," he says, "it's very hard to find a Christian community that agrees with equal treatment of women and the LGBT people. All I've heard from churches is that men are the head of women, and LGBT people are going to hell unless they return to heterosexuality. So I couldn't go to church or belong to a Christian community because I fear being rejected, and also I fear people's anger. And because the LGBT community also hates the church and Christianity, I feel like I'm abandoned and cannot be accepted anywhere. And then I found your book, and it gave me the feeling that I can be accepted somewhere, and it's okay to be a Christian and trans at the same time. Thank you for this. You saved my heart. And please pray for me and other LGBT people who are searching for God but are afraid of Christians." Well, I tell you, Shedsters, reading something like this breaks my heart. I feel disgusted with what religion sometimes conveys to LGBT people as well as others, how they have been treated and still are treated in some churches across the world. So look, whoever you are who wrote this comment, please consider the Holy Shed your home. You are among friends here, and I hope that you find somewhere closer to hand to feel really accepted and included. I wonder if there is some Christian LGBT group present in your city or in your country. I don't know what it's like where you are, but please contact me. My email is davetomlinson@mac.com. davetomlinson@mac.com. I really want to hear from you. So for our candle moment today, what else? I'm asking us to light a flame for this lovely person who wrote the message that I just read out, and also for others, especially LGBTQ plus folk who face rejection or hatred or even violence just simply for being who they are. Maybe you've experienced some of this yourself. I know friends of mine who live in this country who have experienced these things, including the violence, by the way. So if you identify with any of this, well, we're lighting it for you too. Okay, so grab yourself a candle, guys, and light it now, and think about this lovely trans man who wrote me this message, and lots of other people who are struggling just to be who they are and to be accepted for that within a Christian community. So here's a prayer that I wrote with that dear person in mind, but for all of us, you may like to join me in saying these words. God, grant us generosity and love in welcoming people different to ourselves. Courage to resist prejudice and discrimination whenever we encounter it. And persistence in working to repair the world of fear and hatred. Amen. Amen. So, hey, What we're doing in the shed at present, as you know, is thinking about how to read the Bible and still be a Christian. Ironic, I know, but I'm afraid that the Bible does play a quite significant part in undermining the faith of many people. I'm not intending to wade through every troublesome passage in the Bible, obviously, life's too short for that. I mostly want to share some of the ways that I read the Bible which help me to stick with it. So that's what we're doing this week and in some of the subsequent weeks too. Among other things, as you know, we've been thinking about the Jewish practice of midrash, reading the Bible with question marks, as one rabbi has put it. And I'd like also to flag up something called liberation theology. I don't know how familiar you are with this. It began as liberation theology. Now there are many liberation theologies. But originally, liberation theology started in Latin America in the 1960s and, you know, specifically focused on social concern for the poor. But as I say, now that extends well beyond that, really, to all kinds of people and groups of people who are systematically oppressed or excluded or disadvantaged for who they are. The poor and politically powerless, yes, but also women, people of colour, LGBTQ plus people, people with disabilities, to name just a few. And by the way, just to stick a pin there, my good friend and a friend of the Holy Shed, Caroline, she talked about her experience as being a person with disabilities to me in a message last week, in which she sort of flagged up the way in which the Bible sometimes is used in different ways to disadvantage or to prejudice people with disabilities. And that's a really key issue. So, Caroline, we will definitely be covering that in one of our future sessions. Okay, so liberation theology draws on something called a hermeneutics of suspicion. Nice little mouthful, isn't it? It's a kind of midrash, really, but coming out of the Christian community. And this is, a way of reading scripture with a healthy wariness in our minds, and asks, who's got the power here? Who's disadvantaged? And how is faith or God implicated in the oppression or exclusion of people in this scripture? Now, I've journeyed with the Bible myself, well, nearly all my life, which is quite a long time, more than 21 years, I'll tell you. And at one time, it was a fetish to me, but gradually I learned to be honest and argue with the Bible. At times, I'll be honest, I've wanted to throw it in the bin and almost have. Other times I've been utterly captivated by it because I have learned to genuinely engage with the text, to engage with it critically, but also humbly. And it's that combination of those two things which I think is so important. Fearlessly being, critical in our attitude towards what we read in the Bible, but also being totally open in our spirits and our minds to receive divine revelation. So anyway, what we're going to do today is take an example, really. And it's the passage which is often called the binding of Isaac. So this is in another passage from Genesis, which is, I think, one of the hardest stories in the whole Bible, actually. And you know it, don't you? I'm sure you do. I certainly heard it in Sunday school days. Shocking stories to tell to children, but I certainly heard it there. Abraham and Sarah have a son, called Isaac, through whom God promises to make a great nation. But then, very weirdly in the passage, God tells Abraham to sacrifice his son, which Abraham interprets as slay him on an altar. And it says in the passage that God was testing him, though it's not exactly clear what the test was. That's certainly an area of dispute within, the kind of rabbinical community in Judaism. So anyway, Abraham goes ahead. He takes Isaac up Mount Moriah. He binds him to an altar. And then, with knife raised, an angel intervenes and steps in and stops him. And a ram is supplied and is slain instead. Whew. That is unless you're the ram, of course. But anyway, for Jews, this is a really important story. It's a foundational story, really. And believe it or not, it's called the Akedah, or the binding. And it's read every single new year in synagogues across the Jewish world. Muslims also have this story, except for them, it's Abraham's other son, Ishmael, Hagar's son, who is on the altar. Meanwhile, Christians see it as a foreshadowing of God sacrificing his son on the cross, although Isaac isn't actually slain in the story. But hey, never let a detail like that get in the way of a sound doctrine, hey. Now, as you know, I completely reject the theology that says God required the death of his son in order that he could forgive humankind. And just as God, you know, in the story, didn't require the death of Isaac, because clearly it didn't happen. And to me, it's very sad that Christians seldom deal with either the hideousness of the story, because it's just sort of rather brushed over the details of the story, because it's this picture of, you know, Jesus being sacrificed by requirement of God. So the hideousness of the story is never really engaged with. And equally, I think the hideousness of the doctrine of substitutionary atonement isn't really engaged with. It's just sort of this part of the story that is passed on now without anybody seriously thinking, what the heck is this story really saying? Both the story as it is rawly kind of presented to us in Genesis and the doctrine of substitutionary atonement, I don't think either of them, in the way they're commonly interpreted, are really worthy of a God of love. Now, many Jews certainly find the story of the Akedah troubling, and in Midrashic tradition, the rabbis struggle to interpret it. And there's a whole stream of videos you may or may not be interested in on YouTube under the heading of the Akedah Project. And this has got, like, I don't know how many, I mean, dozens of different people within the Jewish community, academics and rabbis and ordinary people, men, women, giving their understanding or interpretation of the Akedah. And it's quite fascinating. I mean, they're very different. They are completely opposed to each other, lots of the views that are given. That's part of the beauty of the way in which, through the centuries, the rabbinical community has operated, that it's about an argument, you know, and, you know, that we are discerning within that argument where we place ourselves. So the fact of the matter is, it's a story with huge gaps and absences. Not least the question, what would Isaac wish to say? Isaac is silent through this, other than in his compliance with what his father wants when they're going up the mountain and asking him in a sort of tragic, childish innocence, where is the offering, father? So that's a huge gap, isn't it? How did this affect Isaac? And what was he thinking? What would he wish to say at the end of this this ordeal? And what about Sarah, you know, his mother? Where is she in this story? Where is her voice in this text? One thing, you know, that we can say is that this event shattered a family. It shattered a family. Abraham doesn't return home. In the text, he doesn't return home. When he goes down the mountain, it says he goes to live in Beersheba. You know, probably couldn't face Sarah. That's my guess. Isaac, rather tellingly, doesn't accompany his father down the mountain, but just disappears from the story until he meets Rebecca, who he later marries. And the rabbis ask, so where was Isaac for those 3 years that they reckon it to be? Where was Isaac for those 3 years? And there are a number of Midrashic sort of answers to this. One says that the angels took him to paradise to heal him from the ordeal of, you know, of looking into his father's eyes as Abraham lifted the butcher's knife. And so, you know, the thought there was it took them 3 years to heal him of this ordeal. That's quite a lot of therapy, isn't it? But, you know, you can well see it. And then the first thing that Isaac learns of his mother in the story is that she's dead. Did she or Isaac ever really get over this whole thing? You know, I mean, if this was just a story in real life today, that's how it would be, wouldn't it? I mean, a family was broken through this event and through this father's belief, at least, that this was what God wanted him to do. And to be honest with you, taking the story as it stands, and this is the problem that we always read these stories, read the Bible through, you know, our own however many years, decades of hearing sermons about it and hearing perspectives, and that goes back through centuries of the church thinking about it. But if we come to the story completely fresh, it's one of the most shocking stories imaginable. So it's difficult to see any positives, unless, of course, you think that it's just really a lesson in blind faith, or that it is just a nice little kind of foreshadowing of the atonement, as I said earlier, which neither of which I totally, you know, reject both of those things. Jewish Midrash, both ancient and modern, mostly interprets this story through the eyes of Isaac, the silent one here in this story. Abraham told him, as they were going up the mountain, that all would be well. Well, I doubt that Isaac ever believed that again. But his name, you know, means laughter. Isaac means laughter. Maybe, I want to think anyway, and some of the rabbis thought this, that the angels taught him to laugh again. And then, of course, he meets a woman, Rebecca, to help him live up to that name. Someone to share his anguish, to listen and bring comfort to him, but hopefully to help him laugh. Many Jews, you know, see themselves as Isaac on the altar, you know, as the Jewish people, often with no angel turning up to save them, you know, like in the nightmare of the Crusades, for example, when Christians slaughtered thousands and thousands of Jews. And then, of course, the whole nightmare of the Holocaust, which changed everything, really. You know, I mean, in theological terms, you know, often we speak about before and after the Holocaust, because, you know, theology really needed to be rethought on so many levels post the Holocaust. You know, the how could this happen? So, I mean, back to the story. Rabbi Harold Kushner, who I quoted last week, who wrote that wonderful book, Why Bad Things Happen to Good People, he believes that Abraham was tested, but not in the way that's conventionally understood. Instead, what he says is, he sees it that it was a test of Abraham's willingness to obey without questioning. Would he or wouldn't he? God spoke twice. First, telling him to sacrifice, to kill the boy, and then to spare him. The test, Rabbi Kushner says, is whether Abraham can distinguish the true voice of God from the false. He writes this, he says, it seems that God chose Abraham to give humanity a fresh start precisely because he saw in Abraham an innate sense of righteousness. And this would test whether he truly deserved that distinction. Will he be wise enough to know that the call to compassion is the authentic voice of God and the call to murder is deception? Ultimately, in the story, I think Rabbi Kushner thinks that he got it right. But at what price? You know, what price to Isaac, to Sarah, to himself? And really, you know, you can't avoid the fact that in the way the story is told, the voice of God is implicated here, because whatever was divinely intended, the impact on the people concerned is something that, you know, needs to be answered for. So, I mean, Rabbi Kushner believes that just as Abraham was tested thousands of years ago, we too are being tested today in our world to affirm the divine voice of compassion over the voice of brutality or bloodshed or, you know, just inhumanity. He says, I believe God is looking for Muslims who will say no to those who speak falsely in God's name. No, I've read the Quran and I find there a God who cherishes life and protects the innocent. And it's interesting, actually, that he's writing about this it's in this book, actually, called Conquering Fear. And he's writing about it in a chapter which is really all about terror, the terror that comes in darkness. And it's a lot in the context of 9/11. So he says he's calling on Muslims to say no to violence, you know, that in the Quran we find a God who cherishes life and protects the innocent. And he says, I believe God's looking for Christians too, who will say no to those preachers who claim that anyone who disagrees with them is the enemy, to affirm love, a God of love instead of hatred, especially revealed in Jesus. And he also says, I believe God's looking for Jews who will say no, who will say no when they're asked to do something in the name of the Torah that actually is a denial of human integrity given by God. Now, another rabbi, Sharon Brous from California, she's very bold in her assessment. She states that she can't for a moment accept faith when it means taking the life of an innocent person or you know, getting anywhere near to that. Killing an innocent because God says so, she says, is not a religious value. And so she sees the value of the text in showing us the failure of Abraham, that it encourages us not to make similar mistakes. She says, I think this kind of blind faith brutality is presented to teach us to resist it, to defy it, to cry out against it, to teach us how to behave. And it's something that was often overlooked, you know, that throughout the Hebrew scriptures, and especially if you look in the Psalms, but elsewhere in the scriptures, quite often the way stories are presented to us is of people protesting against God. You know, I mean, Abraham himself did this, actually, just a couple of chapters earlier in Genesis, when God is set on destroying the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham, you know, comes before him and says, do you really want to do this, God? You know, and he goes through a bargaining sort of process. And that's not the only place this happens. So that's a kind of interesting thing, isn't it? That we're not supposed to just take what is said there by God as something that you just comply with. Throughout the Bible, you've got a righteous tradition of people protesting against God, you know. So, you know, what Rabbi Brous says is, Sharon Brous, she says, we have to contend with the fact that God disappears at the end of this story and an angel takes the place of God. If one were to look at the story without the benefit of thousands of years of commentary, she says, what is this ending about? If God's actually proud of Abraham for his faith, for stepping forward and being willing to sacrifice his child, why wouldn't God say at the end, I will bless you for this? Why is an angel sent instead? And she says she sees that as the hint that Abraham doesn't actually pass the test in the end, that this is a story of failure on all fronts. Of course, I mean, she acknowledges there are people who've walked away from this story reading exactly the opposite to what she suggests. And as she says, that's what's beautiful about being engaged in an interpretative tradition, that people will read it differently over the course of time. They'll read it through the lens of their own experiences as parents or as children or within in the political climate. They'll read it through the lens of whatever's happening socially and politically in their world. And this, she says, is what it means to be part of the rabbinic tradition. And that's something, as I say, that, you know, I can see there is an equivalent of that in Christianity, but I think we're much more shy and less bold, forthcoming in our argument, not just with each other, but argument with the text itself. So for me personally, whichever way we take this story, we must end up condemning violence, especially against innocent people or against children. And especially violence which is in the name of God. I mean, look, just think about this. You know, if someone turned up at church one Sunday and said, God's told me to sacrifice my child, how do you think you would react? commend the person for their faith. Wow, what a believing person this is. What a trusting person. Or would you tell him that he's a complete bloody religious nutter and then call the police or social services? I know which way I'd be going. And I have heard people say some pretty outrageous things in the name of God over the years. So we need to see the dangers of religious extremism, if you like, extremism. And I read this story as a warning against religious extremism. I believe we can only make sense of it when we read between the lines, when we sense what's going on beneath the surface, when we use our brains, you know, and our sense of God-given morality. Surely you can't suspend that because of a story. I think that, you know, it's about when we put ourselves into the shoes of the other characters, Isaac and Sarah in particular, when we listen to their silences. So as the story unfolds, we find Isaac, who never had anything more directly to do with his father in the Genesis narrative. This was an end, you know. We find him bringing Rebecca, it says, into his mother Sarah's tent, which is, you know, biblical speak. And it says he took Rebecca and she became his wife and he loved her. So Isaac, it says, was comforted after his mother's death. And I love this bit as well. I love this bit of the story that finally, when Abraham dies, his sons, his two sons, Isaac and Ishmael, bury him together. You know, now the backstory here, as you probably know, is the breakup between the two sons, between the two their parents. You remember when Sarah thought that she couldn't have a child, she told Abraham to go and kind of have it off, more biblical language, with her servant Hagar, so that they would have an heir, who then bore Ishmael. But once Sarah had a son of her own, then she threw Hagar and Ishmael out, not caring that they may perish in the desert, which they almost did. But as Ishmael was close to death and Hagar is despairing and at her wit's end, an angel again speaks to her, promising that God would make of Ishmael a great nation too. And rather wonderfully, Hagar, the Egyptian, you know, she's an Egyptian woman. She's the first woman in the Bible to be visited by an angel. It's good, isn't it? Hagar the Egyptian is the first woman to be given a promise of descendants. Promises to men of that, but she's the first woman who is given that promise. She's the first woman in the Bible to have a conversation with God of any shape or form. And she's the only person in the whole of the Bible to give God a name, which was El Roy, you see me, the God who sees me, an Egyptian woman. The Hebrew people and Judaism descended from Isaac, the Arab people and Islam descended from Ishmael. And here in the story are these two young men driven apart by cruel circumstances, united in burying their father. And there's another Midrashic interpretation that when Isaac fled from his altar experience, that he went and sought out Ishmael, his brother, and became united with him. I like that version. That kind of works for me. So look at our world, guys. You know, look at the conflict between some of the descendants of Abraham. Some of the greatest conflicts in our world include and involve descendants of Abraham, the three communities of Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. And to me, this brutal, moving story of the binding of Isaac, the Akedah, unfolds beautifully into a story of reconciliation, of friendship, through grief and pain and anguish, something I think that we so desperately need in our world today and often in our personal lives. I want to finish this week with another poem by Eleanor Wilner. I read one last week and I love this book. You know, I got it off the marketplace and it came from Ohio. And the amazing thing is, as you see here, that nobody took this book out, which I think is such a tragedy because I love the poetry in this book. So she's got a poem. The book's called Sarah's Choice, and she's got a poem which is all about Sarah's choice. Now, bear this in mind, you know, what I said earlier, that Abraham argued with God to save people that he didn't know in the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. So why didn't he, in this passage, argue with Isaac? And that's a question that, as the, you know, the rabbis have pondered and chewed over in lots of different ways. One approach to scripture, just coming to the whole summary really, one approach to scripture is to read it literally, as straightforwardly kind of instruction and so on to us. Another way is to approach the Bible to read it meditatively, prayerfully, pondering, mulling it over, like you would a nice, you know, a good poem. And then maybe arguing with it, struggling with it, opening our hearts to how it might speak to us today, rather than just taking it as some kind of dictated message that we've had packaged for us through 1,000 sermons that we've probably heard, you know. So look, it's quite a long poem, but I don't apologise for that, because I think it's a very wonderful poem, and I'm going to read it to you and put the words on the screen. Sarah's Choice by Eleanor Wilner. A little late rain in the desert, in the beauty of its winter bloom. The cactus ablaze with yellow flowers that glow even at night, in the reflected light of moon and the shattered crystal of sand, when time was so new that God still walked among the tents, leaving no prints in the sand, but a brand burned into the heart. On such a night, it must have been, although it's not written in the book, how God spoke to Sarah, what he demanded of her, how many questions came of it, how a certain faith was fractured as a stone is split by its own fault. A climate of extremes, and one last drastic change in the temperature. "Go," said the voice. "Take your son, your only son, whom you love. Take him to the mountain, bind him, and make of him a burned offering." Now Isaac was the son of Sarah's age, a gift, so she thought, from God. And how could he ask her even to imagine such a thing, to take the knife of the butcher and thrust it into such a trusting heart, then light the pyre on which tomorrow burns? What fear would be more holy than the fear of that? "Go," said the voice, authority's own, and Sarah rose to her feet, stepped out of the tent of Abraham to stand between the desert and the distant sky, holding its stars like tears it was too cold to shed. Perhaps she was afraid the firmament would shudder and give way, crushing her like a line of ants who, watching the ants ahead marching safe under the arch, are suddenly smashed by the heel they never suspected. For Sarah, with her desert-dwelling mind, could see the grander scale in which the heel might simply be the underside of some divine intention. On such a scale, what is a human son? So there she stood, absurd in the cosmic scene, an old woman bent as a question mark, a mote in the eye of God. And then it was that Sarah spoke in a soft voice, a speech the canon does not record. "No," said Sarah to the voice, "I will not be chosen, nor shall my son, if I can help it. You have promised Abraham, through this boy, a great nation. So either this sacrifice is sham, or else it is a sin." "Shame," she said, "for such is the presumption of mothers. Shame for thinking me a fool, for asking such a thing. You must have known I would choose Isaac. What use have I for history? An arrow already bent when it is fired from the bow." Saying that, Sarah went into the tent and found her restless son awake, as if he had grown aware of the narrow bed in which he lay. And Sarah spoke out of the silence she had herself created, or that had been there all along. "Tomorrow you will be a man. Tonight, then, I must tell you the little that I know. You can be chosen, or you can choose, but not both." The voice of the prophet grows shrill. He will read even defeat as a sign of distinction until pain itself becomes holy. In that day, how shall we tell the victims from the saints, the torturers from the ancient agents of God? But mother, said Isaac, if we were not God's chosen people, what then should we be? I am afraid of being nothing. And Sarah laughed. Then she reached out her hand. Isaac, I am going now, before Abraham awakes, before the sun, to find Hagar the Egyptian and her son, whom I cast out, drunk on pride. God's promises, the seed of Abraham, in my own late blooming loins. But Ishmael, said Isaac, how should I greet him? As you greet yourself, she said, when you bend over the well to draw water and see your image, not knowing it reversed. You must know your brother now, or you will see your own face looking back the day you're at each other's throats. She wrapped herself in a thick dark cloak against the desert's enmity, and tying up her stylus bowl, some dates, a gourd for water, she swung her bundle on her back, reached out once more toward Isaac. It's time, she said. Choose now. But what will happen if we go? The boy Isaac asked. I don't know, Sarah said. But it is written what will happen if we stay. Whew, that's quite a poem, isn't it? And I suppose for me, I would see this as a form of poetic midrash. And I suppose the kind of way it's set up is it's imagining that God first asked Sarah to sacrifice Isaac, which she didn't do. And presumably from that perspective, the choice that Isaac made at the end was to stay with his father and then went up the mountain then. So, my God, it's such an amazingly powerful poem that bears a lot of thought, really, doesn't it? Okay, well, that's kind of about enough today. I'm pretty exhausted. I mean, I was nearly crying reading that poem. but I hope what you get from all of this is this simple thought. Do not be afraid to engage in a real and authentic way with the Bible. The firmament is not going to fall down upon you, you know. A foot is not going to fall upon you like some little ant walking along. I believe in a God who wants us to engage with God. And that actually is the God so often that I do see in Scripture. So we'll carry on this little journey looking at other Scriptures in the weeks that follow. But coming back to the message that I read at the beginning from the person who described himself as a trans man, I'd like us to listen now to the Lord's Prayer, which I've played before here, but it's so appropriate, by Joe Clifford, who wrote the play Jesus, Queen of Heaven. And let that be our prayer today.
Our Mother who art on earth, blessed is your name. Your joy be here on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily kisses. Forgive us our stupidity, as we forgive those stupidities done to us. Lead us not into self-righteousness or rage, and save us from destruction. Negativity. For yours is the kingdom, the beauty and the joy, forever and ever. Amen.
Okay, well, we're going to drink to life. What else? So if you've got a drink handy, then please grab it right now or pour it out for yourself. And we will make a toast to life. So I invite you, dear friends, to make a toast with me. A toast to life, to courage instead of fear, to love and reconciliation instead of enmity. A toast to struggling with hard questions, to choosing life over death, mercy over zeal. So, dear friends, I invite you to join me now in a toast to life. L'chaim. Ooh, yes. Okay, well, you know the drill here. It's the collection time. So, yeah, always have that at church, don't you? If you like what I'm doing and you would like to support me and Pat and what we're doing in the Holy Shed, you can do it through the coffee link, which is always at the top of the posts on the Holy Shed Facebook page. A million thanks to all those of you who are supporting us, you know, over the weeks or month by month. It is much appreciated. And there we are, I think. Oh, no, I tell you what, I've got one more thing. I've got a picture to show you. What about this picture? So, you know, this week was a strawberry full moon. And I was out for a little late evening walk on my own, and sun was falling, the moon was just beginning to come out, and I came down this one particular street as I came down from the hilltop, and I saw this blackbird on top of a chimney at the bottom of the street, and I saw the moon, and I thought, there is a photo opportunity. That blackbird is begging me to take a photograph. So I had to get the right angle, which meant me climbing up into somebody's garden, and I hope they didn't mind, so I could catch this shot. But what a beautiful, beautiful image this is. Okay, so I think that what we're going to do now is draw ourselves to a close for today. And do bear in mind that if you have some difficult scriptures you'd like to flag up to me that give you trouble, a number of people have done that already, and I'll be working through them, but I'd be very happy to receive them from you. And I'm going to finish in a moment with a little film, a musical film, which I played at the last Soul Space. If you're there, you'll know it and you'll love it. It's a video of two 17-year-old women in Turkey. One of them was born and bred in Istanbul. The other one came from Syria and was a refugee with her family when she was just 8 years old. Now here they are, both 17, with a passion for music. And they launched a thing called Musical Reset, and they're using music and games to help to support and give hope to needy children, especially refugee children in Turkey. So I love it. This song makes me cry whenever I hear it. So I'll give you that in just a moment. I think that's it, really, guys. Have a good week this week. Be brave. Take a stand for life. Decide for life. There are so many opportunities day by day for us to do that. Be kind to those around you. Be kind to yourself. Stay human. And here's a blessing for us. The blessing of God, the eternal goodwill of God, the shalom and salam of God, the wildness and warmth of God be among us and between us now and always. Amen. So enjoy this, and I'll see you soon. Gücün var mı sevgili? Derin sularda ince çaresi aramaya cesareti. Kaldıysa hala benle aşktan konuşmaya söyle canım sevgilim hayat
Anlat bize oyun oynuyor olabilir mi? Yorgun gibi bir halin var. Duyguların karışık olabilir mi? Sil baştan başlamak gerek bazen.
Unutmak, unutmak, unutmak.